Everybody, this is an overview or big picture view of the nephron. So in this video, I'll be telling you what happens in the different parts of the nephron and what those parts are, but not how what's happening is happening. You can watch other videos to get that information. So the parts of the nephron are listed along the top of this slide, and we'll be going through each one. Bowman's capsule, or the glomerular capsule, is where blood is filtered into the nephron, blood plasma. And then we have the proximal tubule, the loop of Henle, the distal tubule, and finally the collecting duct. Let's start with the Bowman's capsule, or glomerular capsule, as it's now more commonly called. As you can see on the label on this slide, more than 180 liters per day of fluid, blood plasma, are pushed or filtered into the nephron tube from the blood. So right away, we can see that the major thing that has to happen inside that nephron, or once we get that fluid inside the nephron, is for the most of that fluid to return to the blood. Because with a blood volume of 5 or 6 liters, and a filtration rate of 180 liters per day, you would immediately urinate out your blood volume if you did not reabsorb most of what was in that nephron tubule back into your blood before it got to the end of the nephron, at which point it becomes urine. So how does this work, this filtration? This is a closer view where you can see that you have into every nephron, and you've got about a million nephrons in your kidneys, into each one individually comes an afferent vessel, so an arteriole. And that arteriole carries blood into a capillary bed. So this is a set of capillaries, the glomerular capillaries, inside this capsule. And the capsule is formed by this sort of sac of fluid that surrounds the capillaries, and blood pressure forces fluid out of the spaces between the capillary endothelial cells into this sac of fluid that then is continuous with the nephron, is the beginning of that nephron tube. So what happens here is that things that are small enough to fit through the fenestrations, the spaces within the capillary cells, are pushed into that tube, but large items like proteins in the blood and red blood cells stay in the blood and exit the glomerulus at this efferent vessel. So what has gone into the filtrate? Water and solutes, any small organic or inorganic solute. So then once we're into the nephron itself, once things have been filtered in at this glomerulus here, then they're inside the nephron tube, but surrounding the nephron tube, even though it's not shown in a lot of pictures because it creates a lot of visual clutter, surrounding that tube are these peritubular, around the tube, capillaries. And that's where we're going to reabsorb, we're going to return almost all of those water and solutes back into the blood. You might think this sounds backward. Why don't we just keep it all in the blood and then just remove the things that we want to remove instead of putting it all in this nephron and then returning almost all of it to the blood? The reason is that if you kept these things in the blood and just selectively removed whatever solutes needed to be removed and let water follow, you would have to use a tremendous amount of active transport. And that costs a ton of ATP energy. Using this method, we can use a lot of facilitated diffusion and other forms of passive transport like osmosis and avoid using a tremendous amount, although there's certainly still some active transport in maintaining the osmolarity, the blood pressure, and the correct content composition of blood. Okay, so where do we go after our glomerulus? Into the proximal tubule. So this is actually a very twisty or convoluted tubule, hence the similar name, proximal convoluted tubule. But often in pictures, it's just flattened out and just called the proximal tubule. So if we imagine that on the, this is one cell forming the wall of the proximal tubule, one epithelial cell. And on the apical side of that cell, it's facing the space inside the nephron lumen. And on the other side, there'll be some interstitial fluid and then the bloodstream. So the direction of reabsorption is left to right here. What gets reabsorbed? Well, remember, we know we need to reabsorb most of the water and solutes back into the blood. And this is independent of whatever is happening, whether you just drank a gallon of water and ate a bag of potato chips, whatever happened. We know that no matter what, we're going to need to reabsorb most of the water and salt. So in the proximal tubule, we're going to reabsorb sodium. We're going to reabsorb chloride, which is not shown here, but will follow sodium electrostatically. And we're going to reabsorb these organic molecules, especially the ones that contain energy. So in a healthy person, in particular, a person who doesn't have diabetes mellitus, 100% of the glucose that gets filtered into the nephron will be reabsorbed in the proximal tubule, 100% of the amino acids. These enter these proximal tubule cells and then are transported out the basolateral side and back into the blood, so they're fully reabsorbed. The other thing that happens in the proximal tubule is that, remember that you're producing carbon dioxide continuously in aerobic respiration, and that turns into carbonic acid. And so we need to prevent our blood from becoming acidified, we need to get rid of acid basically continuously. This is regulated at the distal tubule, as we'll see, but in the proximal tubule, just knowing that we need to get rid of a lot of acid in our blood as the default state, we see the removal or secretion of acid here and the reabsorption of bicarbonate, which is going to buffer the acid that remains in the blood. Okay, so that was in the proximal tubule. By the time we get to the end of the proximal tubule, then we have reabsorbed 60% of the water and solutes that entered. So we've decreased the volume of what has entered quite a lot at this stage, and we've reabsorbed all of the glucose and all of the amino acids that entered. So there shouldn't be any energy-containing molecules left, and there should be only 40% of the water and salt that entered. The next stage is the loop of Henle, and the function of the loop of Henle is through a combination of anatomy and physiology, through its physical arrangement and through its arrangement of pumps and of permeability. It creates a situation where the osmolarity of the filtrate itself becomes more and more concentrated as you go down into the tube itself goes deeper into the medulla, deep part of the kidney. You can see at the bottom of this tube, the osmolarity is about 1200 milliosmolar, which is four times as concentrated as your blood. And the effect of this, of changing the osmolarity within the tube, is to actually change the osmolarity in the interstitial fluid outside the tube, as you can see along the right side of this slide here and through the shading on the whole slide, that as you go deeper into the medulla of the kidney, the fluid, the interstitial fluid there, the fluid around the cells of the tube, is more and more concentrated. And that is important for the possibility of creating a concentrated urine, which happens later in the collecting duct. So the loop of Henle's function is to create this gradient of osmolarity, or an area of high osmolarity deep inside the kidney. And the next step is the distal tubule. You see here that what happens at the distal tubule is variable reabsorption of water and solutes. So here's the distal tubule on that original slide, and here's that labeling, variable reabsorption of water and solutes. What does that mean? Well, everything before this stage was not variable. That is, no matter what your blood pressure and what the osmolarity of your blood, no matter what you just ate or drank, you're going to have everything that just happened happen, no matter what. Now, in this distal part of the kidney, we now have hormones that carry information to this part of the kidney and tell it more precisely. We're now fine-tuning. Okay, we knew we needed to reabsorb most of the salt, but how much exactly? Well, if you just ate a bag of potato chips, you don't need to reabsorb as much salt as if you didn't. So information about your blood pressure and osmolarity of your blood comes to this part of the kidney. In the distal tubule in particular, the hormone is aldosterone. It tells the distal tubule if you need to reabsorb more sodium there. If so, you do. And then finally, we have the collecting duct. In the distal tubule also, though, we also have regulation of pH based on the, you know, again, fine-tuning the pH of the blood. Although you always want to remember that the major regulator of blood pH is breathing rate, but the kidney is an important secondary regulator of that. Now let's look at that collecting duct. In the collecting duct, we have another hormone, which has two names, vasopressin and ADH, antidiuretic hormone. And this hormone carries information about your hydration state to this part of the kidney, and basically allows the reabsorption of water there, as is shown on the left side of the slide. Or if the hormone is not present or present at low levels, we get very little reabsorption of water, as shown on the right side of the slide. And the effect is that the correct amount of water is reabsorbed to allow your blood volume and blood pressure to be correct. So if you did just drink a gallon of water, then you probably have extra water in your body. That is, your blood volume and blood pressure are threatening to be too high, and so you'll produce a very dilute urine, as shown on the right side of the slide. Whereas if you have not had anything to drink all day, for example, then you probably have a high ADH level vasopressin and need to reabsorb most of that, and the result of that will be quite concentrated urine. And this reabsorption of water is dependent on the earlier action of the loop of Henle to create a high osmolarity place to allow that collecting duct fluid to come into equilibrium with that area. All right, so that's an overview of the different parts of the kidney. Remember, you have the part that is unregulated, the proximal tubule and the loop of Henle, and then the distal part of the kidney that is regulated, the distal tubule itself and the collecting duct that allows for fine tuning of water and salt reabsorption to exactly match what your body needs. All right, you can watch more videos to get some details of how this works and let me know if you have any questions.